Hello everybody and welcome to video number 25 of the online version of the Fusion Research Lecture. In the last video we finished with chapter 4, particle trajectories in tokamak accelerator, and today in this video we will start with chapter 5, collisional transport. So let's write that down as a starting point. Chapter 5 will be about collisional transport in fusion plasmas. So okay, we will distinguish, or there are to distinguish, three different main categories or mechanism of transport. First of all, we have classical transport. Classical transport. In classical transport, we just have diffusion through gradients in density, temperature, and potential. So we have, so classical transport is basically diffusive or diffusion through gradients in density, temperature, and potential. And what this means basically is that we have a Fick's law which says that the diffusion flux is proportional to a concentration gradient. So you might remember from other lectures that Fick's law, so this is basically the flux, that this is proportional to a diffusion coefficient and then the gradient in some concentration. So here the density, for example. Yeah, so this is just as an example. For the classical transport, we assume B to be homogeneous. The magnetic field is homogeneous, which means we have a magnetic field, but it is straight. So a straight magnetic field. If classical transport would be the only transport mechanism in a fusion plasma, then a reactor would have a small minor radius, a small radius on the order of 14 centimeters. For a fusion reactor. We know that this is not the only mechanism, but this is just to tell you how a reactor would look like. And this is what people thought in the very beginning of fusion research. So in addition to classical transport, we then have neoclassical transport. Neoclassical transport. And this is transport where we include effects due to the inhomogeneity of the magnetic field in a toroidal geometry, meaning we will use all the knowledge we hopefully gained in the last chapter where we talked about particle trajectories and tokamaks and accelerators. So the neoclassical transport, neoclassical just means that it includes the inhomogeneity of the magnetic field in toroidal geometry. In toroidal geometry, and it also means in toroidal geometry, this is important here for neoclassical, for the expression neoclassical. This also means we are taking into account, for example, mirror effects, and we will see how these mirror effects we discussed in the last chapter will lead to additional transport losses. And then finally, there's the so-called anomalous. Anomalous or turbulent transport. The expression anomalous was basically used because initially it was not clear what this is due to. Turbulent transport is maybe a more physical, meaningful expression because it tells us that this transport is due to turbulence going on in the plasma. And turbulence is driven by gradient in the pressure. So this is pressure, the plasma pressure profile, and the plasma pressure profile drives instabilities, and the instabilities can lead to turbulence, which then can lead to losses. And this is the dominant transport usually. Definitely in tokamaks, The early Stellarators had neoclassical losses as being the dominant losses, however, modern Stellarators, as for example W7X, now also are turbulence, more turbulence dominated. And one can maybe draw an arrow here, something like this, which indicates the direction of increasing strength. Yeah, so if we were to write here, let me try if I can do this. So in, oops. Where's my mouse? Here. So this is the direction of increasing strength. Okay, how will we tackle that? So what we are doing here in this chapter is an intuitive derivation, an intuitive derivation of the transport coefficients. The correct way would be to use the distributions functions, perturb them via transport, and then see how this perturbation is balanced by the thermalization due to collisions. And this will tell us the mathematically correctly derived transport coefficients. However, as we will see, the intuitive derivation quite often gives the exact same result. So as a formally more correct way would be to perturb the distribution functions, perturbation of distribution function, via transport caused by gradients, and see how this is balanced, or calculate how this is balanced by the thermalization again, thermalization due to collisions. Just that you know what would be the correct way. Okay, let's start with talking about classical transport. Classical transport. To tackle or to describe classical transport, we use a random walk approach. A random walk approach. Now, what is random walk? So for that I have a video. Let me see where this is. Random walk. Yes, this one. Oops, sorry. I am sorry about this. Okay. So, what you can see now here is a simulation of a one-dimensional random walk. So what I have done here, assume there you are standing at one position somewhere along a one-dimensional line. Then you cross a turn, and if you get head, you have to walk one step to the left, and if you get tail, one step to the right. And you do this 1,000 times, and then you do this multiple times, and this is a one-dimensional random walk. And here I have made three simulations of that, and you can see how for three examples the trajectories already look quite different. So all of these three walkers, let's say, have the exact same probability, the same starting conditions. So 50% to get a step into the left direction, 50% probability to get a step into the right direction. This is, by the way, also sometimes called walk of a drunken man, because you either get to the left or a step to the right, or for the drunken man is often the example used, a step forward and a step backward. But this was just an example for the 1D random walk. Now, if in the 1D random walk approach, you would plot the probability for the position at the end of the random walk approach, it would have a Gaussian shape. So the probability, the probability for the final position of a simple 1D random walk has a Gaussian shape centered around the starting position. Has a Gaussian shape centered around the starting position. So if we would make a lot of these simulations, we would finally get up a Gaussian position of the distribution, sorry, a Gaussian distribution of the positions at the final end plane. Now, if we vary the step size or the step time or the probability for each step, then we get different shapes. So varying the step size, the step time, stepping time, and the probability for each step, then we get different shapes. The simple random walk approach, as I said, can be modified by varying the step size, the stepping time, or the probability. And then this very simple model can be and is successfully applied to a lot of areas in physics. And just to name a few, Brownian motion, for example, very famous for that. So Brownian motion, then heat conduction, in brain research, so how the neurons move in the brain. Then random walk plays a role in finances. When you follow, for example, a stock market price index, and of course in plasma physics, it plays a role to describe transport processes. Sorry, in plasma physics, and there are numerous more fields which I will not write down here. In general, you can say that, or one can say that the diffusion can be considered as the sum of many random walks. Diffusion can be the sum of many, or can be considered as described as the sum of many random walks by many particles. By many particles. And that allows you then to write down a diffusion coefficient, D, a diffusion coefficient. Diffusion coefficient D equal to L squared, the step size, then over the stepping time. And again, this is the diffusion coefficient, which you would insert in Fick's law of diffusion. So minus the diffusion coefficient times the gradient of the concentration, here the simply the density. And in this diffusion coefficient, as I already said, L is the step size. And since here we have a magnetized plasma, so classical transport means transport in a plasma, so it is the step size perpendicular to the flux surface, perpendicular to the flux surface. And 1 over tau is the step frequency. This is a step frequency. Yeah, so it is important or depending, well, or the main question, let's say, is which, yeah, let's write it like, down like that. So the question, the main question is what values to use for the step size and the step frequency. What values to use here? Okay, let's have a look at the classical transport where we are at the moment. So to describe that, one thing which you can easily imagine is that the particle displacement of the guiding center of a particle is due to drifts and collisions. Due to drifts and collisions. Now here, however, in this example, we have classical transport, which means we have a straight magnetic field and no electric field. So here we are considering the example of classical transport. That means we have a straight magnetic field. We have no electric field, which means there are no drifts. There are only collisions to be considered. Talking about collisions, you might remember from the plasma physics 1 lecture that in general small angle collisions dominate in a plasma. Small angle collisions dominate. And you might also remember that this was expressed by the Coulomb logarithm. And you might also remember the way how to describe the collision frequency. We use the moment relaxation time. And you can say that it takes the momentum relaxation time, of course, wanted to say. It takes the momentum relaxation time tau to rotate. Oops. To rotate the momentum vector, by 90 degrees. So this was the definition of the momentum relaxation time. Here we make the assumption to make it a bit simpler. We make an assumption, and this is a very often applied assumption, that the particles experience 190 degree collision. So instead of many, many, many small angle collisions, we assume it's 190 degree collision within the time tau without being perturbed otherwise. Without being disturbed or perturbed otherwise. Okay, so this is the simplified assumption which we make here. This is an often applied and reasonable assumption. Now let's have a look at collisions for same particles. So first of all, collisions for same particles. So let's try to draw this. I'll sketch this again, a circle. Now we delete a bit of the circle, maybe for example like this, and we copy it because we need it multiple times. We start with some particle here, which moves around in this direction. And then, as you might have guessed already, oh, let's get rid of this here. There is another particle. Let's use a different color for that. There's another particle. Let's draw another circle. Oops. There is another particle. For example, like this. Oops. It's a bit too much. Let's copy this again. Then we move this to here and get rid a bit of, oops, I'm sorry, I wanted to use the rubber, so like this, the eraser I wanted to say, of course. And then we have the other trajectory here. Okay, so this is another particle starting basically here, but it is the same particle, so we should probably use the same color. So the same particle species, I wanted to say. So I said same particles, where same particles means same particles species, right? So two electrons, for example. Moving into this direction, then this here, this is the point of collision. This is where the particles collide. So after the collision, they move on further, for example, to here or to here. Now, if we would draw, look at the center of mass, for example, this one would be here. This one would probably be here. So there would be a displacement from the center of mass from this particle to here. Now looking at the other particle, the center of mass of this one might probably be here, and of that one here. So there would be a displacement into this direction. If we now, let's quantify that. So going down here, let's say this is L1, the displacement. And then here we have L2, and if I, whoops, would have made the drawing a bit better, then L1 and L2 would be the same, meaning that the center of mass of the whole system is not changing. So there is no net, that is important, no net displacement of the center of mass, of the center of mass, also referred to as Berry mass. And that means there is no net transport in this scenario, no net transport. Okay, so how does it look like if we have unlike particles? Unlike particles. So from different particle species, for example, an electron colliding with an ion. So once again, let's try to draw, start to draw with a circle. Maybe like this. Then let's copy this circle. Like this. Then let's use the eraser to get rid of this part here, and also of this part. And now we start with one particle again sitting here, circulating, so gyrating around the magnetic field into this direction. And then here, let's assume these would be electrons. The electron would hit here with an ion. Of course, these are not to scale. This is just an illustration. Then the ion would barely move. I mean, it would slightly move, but barely. The electron would just bounce off, roughly, continue its gyration into this direction. Then if we now look at the center of mass from the electron system, this clearly has changed, right? So this is the displacement of, oops, of the center of mass from the electron system. So now there is a net displacement of the electron by, of the electron population in general by a Larmor radius. Meaning there is net transport. Okay, good. This is an illustration for why there's no transport if the same particle types or if like particles collide, and if there is transport in contrast when unlike particles collide. Now let's try to quantify this a bit further. So let's assume we have collisions of electrons with ions. So ions. Then the step size to get the diffusion coefficient is given, as I've said on the previous slide, by the electron Larmor radius, which you can write as 2ME TE, the electron temperature. Here I have inserted for the velocity the thermal velocity over EB. And the step time tau corresponds to the electron ion, to the electron ion collision time, which you have discussed in your plasma physics lecture. And you might remember that it can be written as 3 times 3 square root of 3 times ME times the electron temperature to the power of 3/2 over the Coulomb factor E squared over 4 pi epsilon naught, the Coulomb factor squared, times 8 pi NE and the Coulomb logarithm, and that this is abbreviated with TEI, the electron ion collision frequency. And from that, the classical, or that allows us to write down the classical diffusion coefficient, the classical diffusion coefficient, the classical diffusion coefficient D CL for classical, then rho, so the electron Larmor radius squared over 2 times the electron ion collision frequency being equal to, so now we insert the standard expression for the electron Larmor radius squared times 1 over 2 TEI, and this is proportional to the collision frequency, which means that the classical diffusion coefficient scales linearly with the collision frequency, something important to be aware of, something we will discuss later on. Now we can insert the thermal velocity again and then write down for the classical diffusion coefficient. We might need a bit more space for that. So inserting the thermal velocity, so V thermal equal to the square root of 2 times the temperature divided by the mass, then the classical diffusion coefficient reads E squared NE square root of ME times the Coulomb logarithm divided by 6 times the square root of 3 times pi epsilon naught squared B squared, and the electron temperature square rooted. And this corresponds to, if you want to sorry, insert some numbers, 2.4 times 10 to the minus 23, or it should correspond to this, times NE times the Coulomb logarithm divided by B squared and the electron temperature. And in the end, as usual, as it should be, the unit of the diffusion coefficient is meter squared over seconds. Now, if we would do the exact calculation, we will get the same results. So the exact calculations, they give the same results, or they give the same result for electrons and ions, meaning that if we look at the ion-Larmor radii divided by 2 times tau IE, that this, there's an I missing, that this is the same as the electron-Larmor radius, which is shorter as the ion-Larmor radius, but it is then balanced by the collision frequency, the electron-ion collision frequency. And this means that the transport is ambipolar, that the transport is ambipolar. So the same for electrons and ions here, two different, so balanced, I should say, probably. So the transport is ambipolar. Okay, that's it for this video, where we introduced or start to talk about collisional transport diffusion plasmas. You definitely should remember the order of the strength of the transport processes, so classical transport, neoclassical transport, and anomalous or turbulent transport. We in this chapter further, or sorry, in this video, talk about classical transport, which can be described using a random walk approach, a widely used approach, where the diffusion coefficient is given by the squared step size perpendicular to the flux surface divided by 2 times the stepping time. And in the classical transport, we inserted for the step size the electron-Larmor radius, and for the step time the collision frequency of electrons and ions, or vice versa for ions and electrons, and that the classical transport is ambipolar. Okay, that's it. Hope to see you in the next video.